Hello and welcome to this second video on Lambda Expressions and Java 8. This second video we will mainly focus on Lambda Expressions, what they are, what is the syntax, and how are they built. In further videos we will analyze streams. Well, what is a Lambda Expression? Basically, the idea of Lambda Expression is to allow to make functions as a first level concept. And these functions are declared on the fly, they're anonymous, we don't have a name for them, and most importantly, we can pass them as parameters, so we can parameterize other elements by passing functions as parameters. This idea comes from the Lambda calculus of Alonzo Church and is one of the bases of functional programming. In Java 8, they are called Lambda expressions, but in other languages like Ruby, they are called closures, which is also a very common name. Lambda expressions were a very important addition to Java 8 because they allow a programming style which is close to functional programming. The idea is that combined with streams, streams are similar to collections or to lists where data flows, and then you put functions that operate over the data that flows from the streams, applying certain functions. And these functions will be typically given as Lambda expressions. This style of programming, you will see that in some cases, leads to code which is more clear, more intentional, reflects better what you want to do, and leaves out many auxiliary details that you would need in traditional programming. Moreover, because this functional style leads in many cases to code that is more easily executed in parallel. We will see that we can very easily, using parallel stream, parallelize the computation. And this is very important if you plan to process large amount of data, like in big data applications. Right, let's start with a motivating example. Remember, in Swing, which is a library to build graphical user interfaces in Java, it's very common to configure the graphical components with callback methods, methods that are execute whenever the user interacts with this component, for example, by clicking on it. Before Java 8, what you needed to do is to define a class for the callback method. For example, this is the way you would do it with an anonymous class. An anonymous class, remember, is a class that is defined and instantiated on the fly. It is defined on the basis of a base class or an interface. For example, here we are using the interface action listener. This is a J button. This is an add action listener that basically is going to place this callback method on this button so that when the button is clicked, this code will be executed. So what we are doing here is actually on the fly implementing a class, creating a class that implements this interface and then instantiating the class because we are calling the empty constructor. The important thing here is that action listener just needs requires to implement just one method, which is action perform. This is the method that is required by the interface, and we are basically just doing some computation here. This method has one parameter, which is the event, information of the event that happened between the user and the button. Right, so this is an interesting situation, right? Because we are doing all these things on the fly, but we could even do better. Because if you think about it, action listener only requires exactly one method to be implemented. So the compiler could be smarter, right? Accept something like this. This is called a Lambda expression, which is a minimal version of this with the minimal information. You see, this is the parameter of the method. We don't even mention what the method is because there is only one method to implement. So here The parameter is of type action listener, and this action listener has just one method to implement. So we know that this parameter is of type action event, right? And here, after this arrow, we put the expression body. In this case, this is just one line, but you can put here a block of code. Overall, this is a lambda expression. So, in summary, a lambda expression is a more concise syntax for an anonymous class, and it's an interesting way to have a code that is less verbose and that goes more to the point. Let's see now an example of a simple computation on how you would do it without lambdas and with the Java 8 functional programming style. Imagine you have here a class product that basically just has a price, has a constructor, and has a getter for the price. And then we have here a list of products which is made just of three products. And then we want to obtain a list of discounts. A product is in discount if the price is bigger than 10. Typically, what you would do is you would create here a for loop iterating over this list of products, put here a condition, and then if the condition is satisfied, then you add the product to the list of discounts. That's a way to do it, works fine. This would be the equivalent using this functional programming style allowed by Java 8. Well, you see that we just have the products here, and what we do is we convert the list into a stream. What is a stream? A stream is a flow of objects over which you can apply different computations. For example, one of the functions that you can apply is a filter. A filter receives a lambda expression, actually a predicate. A predicate that takes the values that comes through the flow and puts a condition on them. If these values satisfy the condition, then the object passes through the flow. Right? So, for example, here we are basically filtering those products that have a price bigger than 10. And if they do, they will pass through this string here. So filter produces another string, and to this string you can concatenate additional functions like mappings and so on. In this case, the only thing that we do is a collect operator that basically aggregates all the objects that comes to this from this stream, and they are collected into a list. So you see that this is a different style where we don't have an explicit iteration, but we convert the list into a flow, into a stream, to which we apply all these operations. Right, let's have a closer look at what is happening in this example here. So we have this filter. This filter produces a stream, right? And receives the condition that the user wants to put. So it's a predicate. What is a predicate? Well, a predicate is just an interface. It's a special interface because it only has one method to be implemented, which is test. These kind of interfaces are called functional interfaces. These functional interfaces, we introduced them in the previous video, and they are special in the sense that they only have one non-static, non-default method, test. And they are very handy because then we can create lambda expressions typed over them. Actually, the lambda expression in the previous slide would be equivalent to this anonymous class. You see, we are creating here a class that implements predicate, and we are providing this code for the test method. But of course, the lambda expression was much more shorter, much more intentional, and much more readable. All right, so let's see a few examples of lambda expressions. Let's try to write a lambda expression just like in the example of the products. So we have something like this, no? X was a product, and then we had something like x dot get price bigger than 10, I believe. So if we do something like this, this of course does not compile. This is a lambda expression, but we need to provide the compiler with more information, and we need to do something about it. So we could try to, for example, assign this to a variable, but of course we need to declare the type of the variable. Let's try with an object, because at the end of the day everything is an object, but of course this is a lambda expression, so it should be typed by a functional interface, and unfortunately object is not a functional interface. So recall that the idea is to have here a predicate of what? A predicate of product in this case. Now this compiles. I'm not doing something spectacular, just creating a lambda expression, so I will try to print it, for example. Let's see what happens. And if we execute this, you see that basically I'm printing the object. Recall that this is equivalent to an object of a class that implements predicate of product. Predicate is a functional interface that is generic, and we are parameterizing this interface with product. Okay, right. So how do I really execute this code here? Well, each functional interface has a method that needs to be implemented. In the case of predicate, the functional method is test. So here we need to pass a product as parameter, and then we can execute this and we'll print true. As I said before, functional interfaces, many of them will be generic, and we can, for example, define other functional interfaces for we can define lambda expressions typed by, for example, predicate of integer. For example, we can say something like this, which basically will check if the integer here is odd or is even or not. And if we print this, again we need to check test. We can test with 30, and if we execute, I will be executing this code here. Recall that the lambda expression is just a concise notation for an anonymous class. For example, we could create here the equivalent of the previous lambda expression using an anonymous class. So that's exactly what I'm doing here. I'm creating an anonymous class on the basis of predicate, and here I have to implement the test method. This test method can say exactly can have exactly the same code as my lambda expression there, and if I execute this code, I will have the same results. Right, but you see that this lambda expression is much more concise than this anonymous class. More things about the syntax of lambda expressions. For example, we can this is a parameter x, but we can also specify the type of the parameter. You do this using this notation here. You specify the type, and then you enclose this parameter between parentheses, right? If this functional interface would have a method requiring several parameters, you would add here more parameters separated by comma. And the idea is that either you put the type of all the parameters, or you don't put any type. That's the idea. Right. Of course, there are many more functional interfaces that we will analyze shortly. For example, you can have functions. What is a function? A function takes one object of one type, for example, a string, and generates an object of another type, for example, integer. For example, we can say that we want to have a function that takes a string and produces an integer with the length of the string, right? That would be a valid function from a string to integer. And now we can again invoke a function, but a function now, the functional method is not test, but in the case of function is called apply. So you will see that every functional interface will have a method to implement, and of course the name of the method can be different. So we can put something like this, and if we execute this, then we obtain the value 7. Okay, just one more detail about the syntax of functional interfaces and lambda expressions. So you see here that each lambda expression that I have presented just has one line of code, which is exactly the return, right? Instead of one line of code, you can have more than one, and you would need to insert here a block, right? But you can put whatever you want here. For example, we can create an auxiliary bar, which will remove, for example, the blank spaces, and then will return the length of this auxiliary bar. So basically, this lambda expression will provide you will return the length of the string once it has been deleted from the blank spaces. But in this case, if you put here a block of code with these curly braces, then you need to put the explicit return. So if the lambda expression has just one line of code, you don't even need to put the return, but if it has a line of code, you need to put an explicit return. And of course, you can put here the code that you want. So you see that here, now the value is 5 instead of 7. Right, so let's go back to the slide. In summary, a functional interface is just an interface with a unique non-default, non-static methods, and there are many functional interfaces that are that comes in standard Java libraries. Of course, you can define your own functional interfaces, and we will be doing exercises where you will need to do that. But it's very good if you learn, try to learn the most important functional interfaces in the Java library. For example, we have seen the functional interface predicate that you can apply on filters for filtering streams. The idea is that you configure this predicate with a type, and then you have the method test where you which expects an object of type T and returns a boolean. We have also seen function, which has two generic parameters, T and R. So you have the functional method is apply, that takes one object of type T and returns an object of type R, for example, to obtain the price of a product or to obtain the length of a string. There are many other functional interfaces like consumer. Consumer basically has a functional method which is accept, which accepts one object and does not return anything. For example, you can use it to print a value or do some computation. Supplier is the other way around. You configure it with one type, you don't get anything, and you return an object of type T. For example, this can be useful to create an object. And then you have operations. For example, you have the unary operator, where the functional method is apply, you expect one object of type T, and then you return another object of type T. One application of this would be to implement a logical negation over one boolean. You also have binary operators that expects two objects of the same type and return an object of the same type, for example, to multiply two numbers. It's important also to know that some of these functional interfaces, they have specialization. For example, consumer has a specialization for integers, because recall that this T here, this parameter, generic parameter, should be an object, so it cannot be a data type like int. And many of these interfaces, they contain, in addition to the functional method, they have default and static utility methods. So in summary, lambda expressions do not have a name, they don't declare the return time because it's inferred from the functional method. You also don't declare a throws clause, and you cannot declare generic types on it. And then the types of the formal parameters, you can omit them or you can put them. So we talk about implicit lambdas where you don't put the type, or explicit lambdas where you explicitly declare the type. Right, now we are going to see a few examples to understand better the syntax of lambda expressions. Here there is an expression, a lambda expression with zero parameters and no return actually. To indicate that you have zero parameters, you just put these parameters followed by the arrow, followed by the lambda expression itself. You could put here a block of code, but in this case we just have one instruction. And this lambda expression is runnable. Runnable is the functional interface is runnable, and runnable is useful for to work with threads where you need to execute computations in different threads. This lambda expression here would be equivalent to this anonymous class where I explicitly create a new runnable. So I call this constructor here, and I need to provide here the implementation for method run. With zero parameters, this syntax would not be correct because you need to put here the parentheses. Okay, let's see more examples. Here is an example of consumer. Consumer, recall, is this functional interface that takes one parameter and has no return. This case is a consumer of product that basically increases the price of the product that is passed as parameter and prints it in the console. And well, consumer is used by forEach. forEach is a method that can be called on a list, and then we'll execute the code of the consumer on each element of the list. You don't need to create an string even. So here we increase the price and print. So if we put products for each, then we can pass also the lambda expression. This will implement a kind of loop, but using lambda expressions. Right, these are all equivalent syntaxes, where we have the implicit lambda, where you don't declare the type of the parameter, you can put parentheses, and with an explicit lambda, you put the type of the parameter. But if you put the type of the parameter, you need to put the parentheses. This would not be a correct syntax because the parentheses would be missing here. Right, so let's see more examples of lambda expressions with more than one parameter. Here, we have reduce, which basically aggregates the elements of this stream. And the stream is created from this list of numbers. And basically it adds all the numbers in the stream, right? So this lambda expression here is conforming to the binary operator on integers. Basically it takes two integers and produces an integer. But in this case, the result is not an integer, but something which is called optional. Optional is a class which is generated, and that is also important in Java 8. The idea is that an optional basically stores either a value or no value. And if there is no value, then you can call methods like or else, so you can print the result. And if the result, this optional object, has no value, then it will print zero. So it's a nice way to avoid having to test for if the value is null or not and do different things. So instead of putting a conditional with an if, you can do it in just one line of code. Again, these two syntaxes would be equivalent. This is the implicit lambda with no information on the type of the parameters, and this is the explicit lambda where you put the type of the parameters. Right. Let's see in more detail what kind of code can you put inside a lambda expression like this one here. This is the example that we had before, where we had a consumer that we passed to a for each, and then in each element of this array, we execute this code here. see that we can access variables that are final and that are in the context of this block here, so we can access with no problem increment. That compiles correctly and executes properly. We can even access variables that do not have the final modifier, so they are effectively final. This will also compile and work properly. But what you cannot do is to modify the value of the variable that is you are using and is declared outside of the land expression. That will give you an error and would not be correct. Okay, with this we finish this video about the syntax of land expressions. In further videos we will go in more details about land expressions and this functional programming style that Java 8 and Streams allows.